Hello everyone, in this video we will walk through a hands-on implementation of Azure Private DNS and I will try my best to explain all the bells and whistles of this resource. Don't forget to hit like and subscribe. Thank you. Let's start with a quick recap about what we have discussed in our previous video and which kind of networking resource we could configure on Azure environment. Then we start with theoretical part of the private DNS, and I promise you to keep this part as short as possible because the sole purpose of this course is to mostly talk about the hands-on experience of Azure and learn Azure with touching the stuff, not just talking about the stuff. Firstly, we mostly talk about vNet and Subnet in the previous course. vNet is somehow equivalent to the conventional VLAN, but the most significant difference here is vNet doesn't support broadcast, but in VLAN you have broadcast. And it is exactly why whenever you are configuring your Azure environment, you don't need a lot of vNets. On the other hand, in conventional networking, you mostly create several vNets in order to keep at bay all the problems of broadcasting and have a segregation in order to enhance the security. But here in Azure, you can use the power of subnets to have that much segregation. Then the biggest takeaway here is you don't need lots of vNets. You can have one vNet, as you can see in the left side of the screen. Here we have just one vNet in East US and several subnets under that. Then you can enjoy power of vNet and subnet in that way. Let's talk about private DNS. Private DNS enables us to manage our resource IP and name in dynamic way. What I mean is having some kind of automation. Let's explain it with just one example. Whenever you create a virtual machine or any other kind of resources here in Azure, if you enable private DNS, you can see the registration of the name and the IP address of that virtual machine in your Azure Private DNS. And you can also delegate your domain, your corporate domain, to the private DNS and then manage all the DNS related stuff on a single pane of glass. So it is one of the wonderful tools of Azure. And the other point about this is you can enhance and increase the security whenever you are using private DNS. The reason is whenever you remove any kind of resource like a virtual machine in your Azure environment, the A record or any kind of record like MX record will get removed immediately after the removal of that virtual machine or resource. So it kind of the biggest advantage of private DNS. It avoids any problem like dangling DNS. No worry, if you don't know what is dangling DNS, we are going to talk about that in the upcoming videos. Now, just bear in mind that a record set cannot contain two identical records. The other thing is that Azure DNS supports all kinds of DNS records, ranging from A record, Quad A record, CNAME, MX record. Another important thing here is delegation. Guys, imagine that you just ordered your domain name from a website like GoDaddy. Now you have your domain name for your organization. Then what you need to do in order to delegate your DNS, all the DNS related things to your Azure, is just register the Azure NS on your DNS provider company. On the left side of the screen, you can see how I delegated all the DNS related things to my Azure. It's just a matter of creation of a text record, as I did here, and entering the Azure NS1 and NS2 here, like the thing that you can see on the left side of the screen. Then from this point, after applying this configuration, all kind of record that I will create on my Azure environment will affect the real world DNS. Now, theoretical part is enough. Let's get our hands dirty and do the configuration here. Before starting our configuration, let's see whether the resources that we created in the previous video exist or not. Yes, we can see our three vNets here, and let's check one of them, manufacturing vNet as an instance, and then subnets. Then we can happily go and configure our private DNS soon. Let's create private DNS soon. Here on the left side of the screen, you can see what I'm going to do today. I'm going to create a private DNS zone and link subnets for auto-registration and create virtual machines. And it makes sense. We need to just spin up some virtual machines to verify the connectivity and the name registration on our private DNS. Then here, guys, we have something which is called vNet link. Guys, you need to do it in order to connect your vNet to the private DNS. In other words, you link your vNet to the private DNS in order to let private DNS zone manage all the DNS related things. And here, after linking our core service vNet to our private DNS, I need to link both West Europe and Asia to the private DNS. Let's do it. First, define a name for our private DNS. Okay, it got deployed. And now let's go to the resource and link our core services vNet to the private DNS. In order to do that, you need to go to DNS management and then virtual network links and hit the add. Link name, just core services, vNet link. For the virtual network, it makes sense to use the relevant core services vNet, which is located in East US. Guys, you need to enable auto-registration. It says whenever you're creating a virtual machine, the relevant name will get deployed within your private DNS zone. Okay, it's done. And now let's link to other vNets. Select the research vNet in Asia, enable auto registration. Add the third one, which is for manufacturing. Keep refreshing to see three of them. Yeah, everything is okay. And now it is time to create our virtual machines. Guys, in order to create the virtual machines, I'm not going to create it via the VM tab here. I'm going to do something else and create the virtual machines by using the power of Azure Cloud Shell. Guys, let's see how we can do that. First, you need some ARM templates. Here you can see our ARM templates. Scalable, as our lab provider, made my life much easier and provided us with this ARM template. Azure ARM templates are nothing except some parameters within a JSON file. We are going to check what's there inside them. Let's open the Azure deploy parameters JSON. You can see the name of virtual machine, the name of network interface card, and some other information about the VM tier. It is standard DS1 username. Let's check the Azure deploy.json, which is the other file. This file contains more detailed information, like the information of NSG, which kind of IP address should be configured on the network interface card, so on and so forth. I'm going to close them. For those who are interested in these kind of things, these ARM templates are a tool that help you to do Azure automation. You can use them in Azure DevOps by other kind of development tools, store them in somewhere like Git and Azure DevOps, and you can also create templates and apply them in your Azure environment by using other automation tools like Terraform, which is beyond the scope of this course. Now let's upload our files. Both files are uploaded as we expected, and now we should execute some command on Azure Cloud Shell. First, let's define the resource group here. Here, by using $resource group name equivalent to the resource group which is provided to us with a scalable lab, we can tell to Azure Cloud Shell we need to use this specific resource group. And then we can do the magic by executing this command. This command defines the template file and the template parameters file, which I already explained. And we also define the variable here. As I already mentioned, $resource group name should be the name of your resource group, which we already entered here. Now it is time to execute this command and see the magic of ARM template. It asks admin password, because as we can remember in the template file, it asks the template password. Can you remember here in the template, you cannot find any sign of password, neither in parameters nor in the main template. Here I can see username, but there is no password, so it makes sense to enter the password here. So finally, we created the VMs by using Azure templates, ARM templates. It says that created two VMs. You can see the VM size here and the username. Now it is time to verify the creation of the records in our private DNS zone. Let's minimize it. Yeah, it's working. Go to the private DNS, and here you can see the domain name that we entered as the name. Here, under DNS management, under record sets, you can see two records. Both of them are A record, so it makes sense. We just enter the name of virtual machine and receive the result. As you can see here, we only need to resolve the name to the IP address. So A record works for us. The value is the IP address, as you can see here, the IP address of the virtual machine. Now let's do some basic tests. Let's connect to the virtual machine using remote desktop. Guys, now I'm connected to test VM number 1, and I want to see whether I can connect to the VM 2 by using its name, not the IP address. Let's open the CMD here and see who am I first. I'm test VM number 1. Let's now ping. Okay, the good news here is it could resolve the name. The bad news here is timeout. I assume it should be from the firewall. Now let's connect to the second virtual machine. Let's turn off the firewall on the second machine. Of course, I never ever recommend anyone to turn off the VM's firewall in the production environment, but here it's a test, so you can enjoy a shutdown firewall. Now let's return to the VM1 and ping again. Okay guys, it seems everything works fine. I can resolve the name and ping the second VM. So now our private DNS zone is done. The next step is to link our vNets. Can you remember? Here we created three vNets. One core service vNet. We deployed two VMs within that. Now we want to connect these three vNets, which expanded through different continents together. What I mean is, whenever I'm sitting in Asia and ping a VM in West Europe or East US, I will be able to receive the response and I will see the connectivity between those VMs. Just hit the like button and subscribe my channel, and let's keep in touch for the peering video.